Hi, welcome to the second edition of No Sleep. I'm your co-host, Jason Vance.
And I'm your other co-host, Regent St. Clair, and we are the show that's dedicated to showing you the greatest films you've probably never heard of.
Or if you're a movie collector like we are, then you've probably heard of some of these movies and seen them before, but not for a long time. This will give you a chance to revisit them.
And we're also going to span the globe to show you what the infamous as well as the famous love in the world of cinema, and as well, what you, the viewers, like.
And you know, there are just so many great, secret, buried, forgotten treasures of cinema out there, and we're really lucky and fortunate to have some time this week to bring just a few of them to you.
And the theme of today's show is the truly disturbing. And we'll spend the next half hour with you discussing...
Or disgusting, as the case may be.
I'm hooked on disgusting right now. Discussing what it is that makes a film traumatizing and hence disturbing.
You know, and these are films that we feel are really cool. They're great films, but, you know, they also leave you with a very uneasy feeling long after you're done watching them. And it's almost an emotional commitment sometimes just to sit through a few of these. Oh, and just a word of warning, if you have any small children in the room, the time now is to tell them to leave.
Bedtime, kids, because we're not talking about Salvador Dali cutting an eyeball with a razor blade, which is fine.
Valuable, entertaining.
But that's a different show. Today's show, we're going to be concentrating more on films that leave these indelible psychological and emotional marks, scars, marks, use whatever term you will.
And, you know, just a warning, which we rarely are going to give, but
take note.
We mean what we say, so sit back and strap into your straitjacket. My first choice for most disturbing film is a French film called...
Baxter!
And you'll get that joke after you see the film, but this movie takes place in three chapters, and it's actually the story of a bull terrier that lives with three different owners throughout the film. And this dog thinks just like humans do, psychologically scarred humans. And it's subtitled, and it works really beautifully because you hear him speaking French, but you are reading the subtitles, and it's very effective. And Baxter has a lot of demented issues. The first woman he lives with, an elderly woman, he decides and plots to kill her because he becomes sexually obsessed with the next-door neighbor, this little hottie that lives next door.
Understandable, of course.
After he does murder the old woman, he moves in with them, but doesn't stay for long because he does try to kill their child and ends up with a young boy who's being raised a strict Aryan Nazi who begins to train Baxter to become a vicious dog. Let's take a look at this clip of Baxter spying on his neighbors.
N'eut un tel plaisir. Alors, plus tard, quand le silence sera retombé, en concentrant toute mon attention, j'entendrai sa voix à elle. J'imaginerai le bruit du tissu contre leur peau quand ils se déshabillent et les odeurs de leur corps. Et après, quand la lumière s'éteindra, je guetterai les bruits qu'ils font dans le noir. Et puis la vieille viendra me chercher, ça peut plus durer. Faut que je lui fasse comprendre que c'est dangereux de rendre une créature malheureuse, surtout si cette créature est plus forte que vous.
Baxter, viens mon grand.
And you know, this ain't Benji, okay? This is a disturbed animal. Just as human beings can be so messed up, so psychologically damaged, this dog is like us. And that's what's the most interesting thing to me about this film is that an animal or our pets can be just as messed up as we are and react in just as many bad ways
and psychologically scarred from events in their lives. And how about the scene where he is with the other dog?
That actually was the clip I would have shown myself. At some point, Baxter goes and has sex with another dog, and he is just disgusted with himself for doing this. He feels he has no control over it, and it's making him sick to his stomach that he is so weak that he can't even say no to having sex with another dog.
No, he'd much prefer having sex with the woman next door. That's what he really wants.
Understandable, of course. My first film for today is Gummo, which of course came out in 1997, directed by Harmony Korine, with Chloe Sevigny and Max Perlich. And this film is unusual in that there's not particularly a storyline or a character arc. It simply is a little window into these people's miserable white trash lives and the horrible things that they do and that they're subjected to, but that nobody seems to notice is so bad. So the thing is that we get to see some of these things. I've chosen a clip for you wherein a little boy, the main character, is just taking a bath, yet it is very, very disturbing. So take a peek at the main character here who is taking a bath.
If you're from a small town, you'll probably relate to quite a bit of this.
And here we go.
Now, just shortly after this, his mother comes in to serve him a plate of spaghetti in the bathtub.
Right.
And the thing about this movie, it's this small town and the people in it, and I'm using the term people, not actors, because I don't think most of them are.
Most of them are not actors, in fact.
Are just doing so many twisted, demented things in their daily life that they don't see anything wrong. They don't bat an eye at these horrible things going on. And there's no linear storyline. It's just kind of like a slice you get to see behind closed doors in this little white trash existence.
But it's engrossing because it's so foreign to everything that we know. And the scene that we've talked about before, there are two actual brothers, real brothers in the film, who are bodybuilders, weightlifters. And at one point, one of them just says, "Hey, man, let me have those shoes." And the brother goes, "No way, man." And they start hitting each other and punching each other with these huge hand
You can
fists.
Tell they are not members of the Stunt Actors Guild, okay?
This is definitely
it's
not
for real,
acting. It's real fighting with brothers.
It's not just gross, it is engrossing. Now, my next choice is a film called The Reflecting Skin, and I am challenging you to watch this movie, okay? This is a double dare. And
I dare you!
This movie just has about every perversion available in it. But on the surface, it's a very small, quiet, very beautifully filmed. The cinematography is amazing. And it's a story of a young boy in the 1950s, lives in a very tiny prairie town. And because of these bizarre circumstances, he becomes convinced that a widow that lives close by is a vampire. However, there's absolutely nothing supernatural going on at all. But you can see very much through the point of view of this child
how he could
swear on a stack of Bibles it is. And, you know, this clip that we're going to see here, something from his father's past has come back to haunt him, and his father's just about to off himself right in front of his son. So this is pretty much one of the more mild things that happens to this little boy. So let's take a look at the clip, and you'll see what I'm talking about.
And again, as Jason said, what is so fascinating about this film is even though nothing supernatural is happening, you can totally understand how the little boy can perceive it all as supernatural. The neighbor who's a vampire and the sickness that his brother Viggo Mortensen has in the film is he's come home from the war and he's got some sort of radiation illness, and the little boy just sees this as the vampire preying on him. By the way, the setup for the clip that we just saw, in case you didn't catch this, dad is sucking on a gasoline pump when he torches himself.
And, you know, one of the things, you know how most of our parents when we were children would say, threaten us with the belt? Mm. Well, his mother, all she says is, do you want the water? And the little boy will do anything to avoid the water. So you'll have to watch it to find out what that is. But I'm telling you, I'd prefer the belt any day.
But the thing is, of course, that taking something normal, taking something very simple like a glass of water and making it into something horrifying is what this movie does best.
Does so beautifully.
Well, my next film is Happiness, which came out in 1998, directed by Todd Solondz, of course, who directed Welcome to the Dollhouse. Unfortunately, Happiness has none of the cuteness and none of the charm that Welcome to the Dollhouse had. This is a very, very disturbing movie from the very first frame, which is a breakup scene with John Lovitz, does a magnificent job in the opening sequence. It's almost like the Robert Altman film Shortcuts.
Yeah, series of vignettes.
Yeah, little vignettes where all these seemingly unrelated people and unrelated situations really are related, either by friends or by family members or what have you. And it's just unbelievable misery. The dysfunction and the perversion that lurks just beneath the shiny surfaces of everyone's life in this film is unbelievable. We're going to show you a clip here, and the setup is that this guy who we're going to be seeing here is a very well-liked and renowned psychiatrist.
Respected family man.
And so he basically has to run out to the 7-Eleven to get a teen magazine so that he can have an experience in his car. So check this out.
Wow, now that makes you ask the question, who is more dreamy, NSYNC or the Backstreet Boys? But, you know, this guy, what you forgot to mention is that not only is he a respected family man, he's also a slash pedophile serial rapist.
Oh, I forgot to mention the pedophile serial rapist part
and,
of it, too.
You know, this film, it's just one disturbing thing after another, and no matter what you can come up with, he cranks it up a couple notches. Philip Seymour Hoffman is in the film, who was also
from
in Boogie Nights and Patch Adams, the upcoming Flawless, and this movie probably has the best non-pornographic cum shot I've seen in a while.
Absolutely.
Where after he ejaculates on the wall, he sticks postcards against it. And
there's a lot of postcards stuck to his wall.
A lot of postcards against the wall. I mean, this guy is so sleazy, it just, again, it makes you want to shower when you
and
get home.
And the woman, again, with this connection thing, the woman who's into him is
Cameron Manheim
from the practice.
Practice.
And she's got her own problems and her own perversion and weirdness. And also one other thing I got to mention is Lara Flynn Boyle is a writer, very famous and successful in this, and she writes books called Rape at 11, Rape at 12, Rape at 13. And
okay, enough of that.
Well,
enough of that.
That's enough.
Our next pick is actually our producer, Cassandra Lee's choice.
Indeed.
She's done such a wonderful job producing the show, and she had a film that really disturbed her. It's called Boxing Helena.
And this is not a movie about fisticuffs. It's not like Rocky.
It's not Rocky VI. It actually is about a brilliant surgeon who's obsessed with Helena, played by Sherilyn Fenn, and he actually ends up amputating both her arms and legs so that she's
totally dependent upon
completely dependent on him.
Understandable.
Now, a lot of you may know this movie just because of the lawsuit that Kim Basinger and the filmmakers were involved with, where they sued her based on an oral agreement. But let's take a look at this clip. It just shows how pathetic and whiny Julian Sands is and how obsessed he is with Sherilyn, who's such a bitch to him.
And here we go.
Nick, this isn't a game. Where's my book?
I'm not playing a game. Here's your drink.
I had my drink.
some food.
What is wrong with you? I told you, I am not hungry. I want to... You son of a bitch. You had this the whole time?
No, I'm just kidding. Here they are.
But also in this film is Bill Paxton, who is hysterically funny.
Yeah, and you
movie.
Know, she treats Bill Paxton the way same way he
he's
treats
treating her,
you know?
In that particular scene.
And this was directed by David Lynch's daughter, Jennifer Lynch.
And when Jason and I actually saw this film in a theater, we were lucky enough that Jennifer was there, and she came down to the front and spoke before the film and said, it's okay to laugh. It's okay to laugh at this. People worry that they can't laugh at something so dark, but it is so absurd that sometimes you have to laugh at it. I mean, to cut off somebody's arms and legs to make sure they'll be dependent upon you is a little bit over the top. But, you know, what would you expect from David Lynch's daughter to come out of the gate with a film
Absolutely.
Like this?
Absolutely. And I think Sherilyn Finn and Julian Sands both have extensive background with dealing with bizarre material. And
exactly.
I think that they really pulled it off well.
Yeah, and the thing about Kim Basinger is that I cannot see her having done this film. Sherilyn Finn is 100% right on in this role.
Now, my next movie, there's nothing funny about it at all. This is one of the hardest films for me to watch. It really is. But I did it for you people, okay? I'm feeling emotional already. But this is a story about a woman, Mimi Rogers, who is a telephone operator by day. And her life is so pathetic and dull and boring that she's a hardcore, very promiscuous...
Swinger.
She's a swinger, baby.
I believe the term that they use these days.
Well, one night while she's having one of her little decadent orgies, she notices this tattoo on one of the women that she's doing, and she has a revelation, a spiritual revelation that causes her to become born again. She becomes a hardcore Christian.
Bible thumper.
Marries a man, David Duchovny, in what we think is probably his first film role. They have a daughter, but after the husband is brutally murdered for no reason, she loses her faith completely, takes the daughter to a national park to camp, and waits for the rapture. Let's take a look at what her and her daughter are going through here.
Camping.
It's okay. Oh, baby, you're just hungry. We'll get something to eat. We'll go to town.
No, we can't leave.
Yes, we can.
But we don't need any food. God will give us food when we get to heaven. I'll be in heaven tonight. There was a river, and I was in heaven.
Where was I?
You were there.
Good.
Sort of. You were there. Only sort of.
It's almost morning. As soon as the sun comes up, we'll get something to eat.
Ow.
Yeah, this film is so intense. It is so seriously intense. What she goes through with her daughter and regarding Duchovny's death, maybe this is some connection here with her and Duchovny both being on The X-Files.
That's got to be why she got on The X-Files.
I don't know. But I think what makes this film so disturbing is that everything she goes through in gaining her faith and losing her faith are things that we all would go through.
Absolutely.
And this film has, without a shadow of a doubt, one of the most disturbing and unsettling endings of any film you'll ever see. And I'm not talking about blood. I'm not talking about gross.
No.
I'm talking about an idea that of the way that someone could embrace and lose their faith and lose the kingdom.
Yeah, you know, some of the recent movie, Dogma, tackled some of these religious issues. Very tongue-in-cheek, very broad comedy. This tackles the same issue with absolutely no humor at all. But it certainly leaves you with a haunted feeling. Check it out if you're up to it.
My next film is John Waters' Desperate Living.
All right!
And I think it's good to kind of wind the show up on this kind of a note, because actually in Desperate Living there is some humor. It's very disturbing, its ideas, but it has some humor in it. If you've never seen a John Waters movie, I think this might be a good place for you to start with John Waters. He's made films like Polyester, Female Trouble,
Hairspray.
Hairspray in the more mainstream
vein. Pink Flamingos.
Pink Flamingos is what you might have heard of. Also with their own disturbing scenes in them. But for my money, Desperate Living has got the most disturbing concepts of all. A rich woman and her black maid murder the rich woman's husband, and they're on the lam. They're on the run, and where can you go? Well, if you can't go to the police or, you know, skip town, you can go to a place called Mortville.
Mortville.
And Mortville is a sort of fable-like city where the bad people go who are on the lam from the law. It's ruled by the evil Queen Carlotta. Watch now as she dispenses some discipline to her unruly daughter, Princess Cuckoo.
Let the last trump, Cuckoo! I hereby proclaim... Shut up. I hereby proclaim that you are no longer the Princess of Mortville. You'll be gang raped by my soldiers, injected with rabies, and exiled to the streets of Mortville, where you belong.
I consider that an honor, Your Royal Hogness, to once and for all be freed from this mockery of a monarchy. I will never live down the shame of my inherited name, but I will do my best to see that you topple from the throne.
Seize her and fuck her! Yeah!
Now, you know, one thing is that this was done on a no budget, and the production values make it seem sort of campy, but all we have to say to that is
thank God
that it's campy and the production values.
Because a lot of the ideas are so extreme. There's one beautiful part where one of the characters has just had a sex change and had a penis attached, but her girlfriend doesn't like that, so she takes a big pair of scissors and cuts the penis off and throws it out the window as she's bleeding to death. And a dog that just happens to be going by sniffs it, eats it, and runs off. Thank God they had no budget for that special effect. And there are a lot of them like that in this movie.
Absolutely.
Really disturbing ideas.
Certainly a good introduction for John Waters. And how could we have a film, a show about the most disturbing films without including
Waters.
Him?
I mean, absolutely.
The guy's a pioneer. Well, damn it. That's all the time that we have left for today. But a few other great disturbing films we just didn't have a chance to talk about. But we'd love you to see, too, if you like these, rent these other choices also. I'd like to recommend The Hanging Garden, Henry, Portrait of a Serial Killer, Star Time, Naked, any film by David Cronenberg.
And I would like to add to my list that we couldn't show you today, Necromantic, The Magic Christian with Peter Sellers and Ringo Starr, also Man Bites Dog, The Plague Dogs, which is an animated film that is unbelievably powerful and unbelievably sad.
Man.
And as well, Kissed, which came out a couple years ago, another film about necrophilia.
Boy, Plague Dogs is one of the saddest films I have seen, I think, and it's animated. You know, if you want any further information about any of these films we talked about and other films, please give us a call. 310-712-1973, the year KISS was formed, 1973, okay?
Or you can email me, regent@nosleeptv.com.
Or you can email me, jason@nosleep.com. Or you can email our producer, Cassandra at nosleeptv.com.
Somewhere in there was actually what it was.
Cassandra@nosleeptv.com.
That's right.
And we want to hear from
you. So email us or call us and let us know what your favorite movies are. And we might just put you on the show and share all the sort of details with our other viewers. So thanks for tuning in. Come back next time.
Come back. We want some audience participation. Thanks for stopping by. Make sure and stop by again. You won't regret it.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.